Hey guys, welcome to Cakewalk Cambridge. I'm Aisha, and today we're going to start with Chapter 16, Reproduction. This is a chapter that a lot of you guys wanted and have asked for repeatedly, so I hope this helps you. I'm going to be breaking this chapter down two into separate parts. So this segment is primarily going to deal with asexual reproduction, which is the first part of your textbook. So let's get started. Okay, so reproduction, as we know, there are two types of reproduction, asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. The first most important thing that you need to know about these two are their definitions. So let's get into it. So asexual reproduction is a process resulting in the production of genetically identical offspring from one parent. Okay, so basically, what do you mean by genetically identical? It means that they possess the same combination of genes, the same number of genes, the same type of genes, everything is the same. It's as good as producing a clone, okay? That is when it's genetically identical and only one parent is required. That means the daughter cells can bud off or can like be fragmented from that one parent. Whereas sexual reproduction involves the fusion of the nuclei of two gametes. If you guys don't know, nuclei is the plural form of nucleus. So it involves the fusion of the nuclei of two gametes to form a zygote, and the production of offspring are genetically different from each other. So the most basic example in this is human reproduction. You are the product of fertilization between the sperm from your dad and the egg cell from your mom. So the nucleus from the sperm cell and the nucleus from the egg cell fuse together in fertilization. Okay, and that formed a zygote. A zygote is what you originally were, and then you like morphed into an embryo, and then you, of course. So basically, and if you realize, if you know, of course, you are genetically different from your mom or dad. Maybe your dad has light eyes, your mom has dark eyes, and you have dark eyes. Or maybe both of your parents have light eyes and you have dark eyes. So we've already looked at these combinations in inheritance. So that shows how you're genetically different from your parents, okay? Because you may have short parents, but you may be tall yourself. Okay, so let's get into that. So now the definition of asexual reproduction, genetically identical offspring and one parent are two keywords. And the third keyword that has to be mentioned without fail is mitosis. So you need to say a process resulting in the production of genetically identical offspring from one parent by mitosis or through mitosis, okay? We've already gone into what mitosis and meiosis are, so I'd expect you to go back to that chapter in inheritance and just go over that bit again. And for sexual reproduction, you need to first write fusion of the nuclei of two gametes. That is basically what fertilization is. So your definition of sexual reproduction includes fertilization and then the production of offspring that are genetically identical, are genetically different from each other. So you have fertilization and its result. Okay, that's basically what your definition is. So now in sexual reproduction, we already discussed fertilization. And we already know this from chapter 17. The nuclei of gametes, which are basically sex cells, are haploid, which means they have half the number of chromosomes in a body or somatic cell. And the nucleus of a zygote is diploid, which means it will have 46 chromosomes, whereas a haploid cell will have 23 chromosomes in human beings. And in asexual reproduction, you just have some basic examples like cloning, vegetative propagation, and binary fission. Cloning can be seen in I learned about this in grade 9 or 8. There was a sheep that was cloned because it produced really good wool. So when you clone it, you produce another sheep that is genetically absolutely identical to the sheep. So you get the same outcome of wool, the same quality. Vegetative propagation is what happens in plants. We're going to look into that in the next slide. And binary fission is the process through which bacteria divide asexually. That is, a bacterial cell just divides into two and that divides into four. So it all happens exponentially. So when you are asked about how a bacteria divides, you need to write either by asexual reproduction or by binary fission. Both are accepted in your exam. Even mitosis is accepted, but I feel using a more specific terms like specific to bacteria would really help you. Okay, now we're only going to look at asexual reproduction. That was just an overview of the content, and it was put down as per your syllabus requirements. So we're first going to look at fungi. Okay, one thing you need to know in your textbook, there may be a lot of information about different types of asexual reproduction and different examples. You do not need to know all, you just need to know the fundamentals and the dynamics of how asexual reproduction works. Like, if they show you a bacterial cell dividing and you see the same number of chromosomes in both, the same structure in both, you should know that that is asexual reproduction. You need to be able to identify such case studies. You do not need to get into the specifics of like every plant and how asexual reproduction takes place. Okay, this is just a general overview that you require. So don't get worried about this. Okay, so fungi. So first they disperse single-cell haploid spores. So these act basically as your gametes, like how you have gametes in humans and in plants. So fungi has a haploid spore, which means it has half the genetic material, half number of chromosomes in your spore. These spores are carried away by air currents to different places. They grow hyphae or hypha, which is basically a thread-like structure that extends from the spore. Okay, this develops into a body called the mycelium. And now this mycelium grows over food or over the barks of trees or any such, or over other plants, and it digests the barks of trees or like the plants or whatever, and absorbs nutrients from it. So you probably see this on trees when you have like fungi, like brackets of fungi, like stuck to the tree. That is the mycelium that is digesting the nutrients in the tree and absorbing it. So these tend to primarily weaken the barks of trees as well. That's how a lot of trees fall down. That's what you need to know about fungi. Mushroom. The mushroom belongs to the fungi kingdom. So as you know, it produces spores, which are like these circular kind of structures. They germinate and produce hyphae, as you can see, these long thread-like structures. This develops into a body of mycelium, which then uses nutrients from like different sources and develops into a proper mushroom, like a proper body. Okay, and that's how it obtains its nutrients. Okay, now this slide has a lot of information. Don't worry about it. Okay, these are just some examples. So vegetative propagation is what happens in like flowering plants. So basically, in some okay. So if you've looked at the strawberry, we're gonna look at how the strawberry reproduces asexually. So you have the main shoot of a plant that produces flowers, okay? And in between the main shoot, you have these small lateral bulbs. I'm gonna try and draw it for you. Okay, so this is your main shoot. Okay, you have flowers that are produced like this. And as we know, flowers develop into. Okay, so this is what happens. And in between these flowers, you have small lateral bulbs. So as these flowers mature and start producing flowers, these bulbs also mature and they grow longer like this, and they start producing flowers at the ends as well. Okay, because what happens is on this edges of these buds, there are little spores from which a whole plant can grow. So as the flowers mature, these buds mature as well. They grow longer and they move horizontally towards the soil. Okay, like parallel to the soil, and they produce flowers, which then can produce like roots and everything from there, and soon another fruit is produced at this point. Okay, so there are two like things. So one is, this is called a stolon when this happens, and like when it goes over and then into the soil. And there's another part called a rhizome, which is when it grows parallelly to the ground. Okay. You do not need to know these technical terms. I assure you, I've already like sorted a million past papers and they've never asked you about it. I even went through your syllabus. So yeah, that is pretty much what it is. Then in this in your second example is when you have plants which have like tubers. So if you look at a potato or like a daffodil, they're grown underground. So if you look at a potato, it has a lot of starch in it. And why? Because the potato tuber acts as a storage organ. So what happens is the leaves on top photosynthesize and everything, and they produce sugars and starch, right? They produce sugars, which is then deposited in the potato tuber as starch. The tuber stores these energy sources. And so in the spring, when the plant is just forming new leaves, so to form new leaves, you need energy, right? And where will you get energy? From nutrients. And the nutrients come from starch. So when the potato plant needs to form new leaves on its stems. It obtains nutrients from the starch in the potato leaves. You need to remember in spring, this happens in spring when new leaves form. This has come in an MCQ before and I'd gotten it wrong in my prelim exam, my mock. So I think you should remember this. So the bulbs act as a source of nutrients during spring. When nutrients are deposited in them, nutrients also go to the lateral bulb. Okay, this is another part of it. So you have a bulb. I'm just gonna take another color. So you have a bulb which is underground, okay, and you have a lateral bulb which is like this part. This is your lateral bulb and this is your main bulb, okay. So what happens is as the tuber starts getting bigger, starts storing nutrients, the lateral bulb buds away from the main bulb, okay, and it forms its own bulb, okay, and that can produce its own independent plant. Okay, that is pretty cool. And your third example is tissue cultures and cuttings. So basically, if you have a rose and you cut a bit of the stem from the rose and you put this stem, the cut piece of stem, just the stem, into another solution with nutrients and water, soon you will see that the stem grows roots from the bottom and a flower will also grow from the top. Okay, and this is how you can use tissue cultures and cuttings to produce an independent plant. It's pretty cool, actually. I've done this with my grandmother with rose, actually. So I'd say you can remember this point because it actually, it's very cool to know that, you know, a proper plant, an independent plant can be produced from just a stem. So that is all by asexual reproduction. Okay, as you can see here, this is a runner, which is also called a rhizome. As you can see, this is a lateral bulb. These are the main shoots, the main leaves. Here, this is another lateral bulb. It grows horizontally towards the ground and produces an individual plant, as seen over here. Then you have the onion bulb. You can see there are so many tubers, okay? You have a lateral bulb that buds off from it. Okay, and the last example is hydra. Now, this is actually an animal, okay? It's like an aquatic animal. From whatever I've heard, it is an animal. I will just recheck that again and get back to you in the next video. So basically what happens is you can see this little lump here, right? Yeah, so as hydra absorbs nutrients and everything, the bulb grows bigger. And soon when it is big enough and has its own nutrients, the bulb just buds off from the main plant, okay? And it forms its own side plant at the bottom, okay? So that's how the hydra kind of, you know, buds off. And all of this happens by mitosis and binary fission. As you can see, this is one cell in the, so this is how the bulb basically grows in size. You have one cell, the nucleus divides, then the cell divides in cytokinesis, as we've already seen before, and two daughter cells are formed. So this process keeps happening until the that bulge over there becomes big enough to bud from the parent and form its own independent organism. And that is how it works. Okay, and now in the last part of this chapter, you have the advantages and disadvantages. So the advantages of asexual reproduction, as we've seen, no mate is required. You know, it's energy efficient, less energy is required for it, less time consumption, because it's much faster. You know, there's no time required for growth. Then you have advantageous characteristics are passed on. So if you clone, as I told you about the sheep, the sheep was cloned. I think it was called Dolly. I'm not really sure. When you clone the sheep, you have the same genetic material passed on and the same combinations. So the same advantageous alleles and characteristics are passed on that can help an organism adapt better. The organism grows in favorable climate because usually in asexual reproduction, the organism grows right next to the parent plant. Like even if it buds off, it's close. There's not much dispersal. Okay, so if the climate is favorable for the parent plant, it will also be favorable for the daughter plant. And of course, you can store large amounts of food as seen in the potato tuber. It stores starch for like the winter or the or spring when you need energy to like grow new leaves or anything. Now the disadvantages, that is loss of biodiversity. Biodiversity arises from nothing but variation. Variation is when there are differences in characteristics or traits genetically in an organism. Two is that there is increased competition for nutrients. So because the daughter plant is like growing so close to the parent plant, both of them are going to compete very aggressively for the nutrients prevalent in the soil and in the atmosphere. So that increases the competition for nutrients, and the problem is there may be like nutrient deficiency in the soil then for the plants. Okay, so that is another disadvantage. And now if they have genetically the same characteristics, if there is a disease that wipes out one plant, the disease will wipe out all the other plants because there's no variation, there's no mutation, no disease resistance. The whole population is wiped out and may be extinct in a while. And the last point is that harmful alleles may be passed on. So of course you will have advantageous alleles as well, but with the good comes the bad, and there will be some harmful traits that may be passed on to the daughter plant or like the daughter organism. That is always a problem. So yeah, that was the first part of chapter 16, asexual reproduction. It's quite easy, not much to know. You should just understand the concept, grasp it, okay? And I will also be doing a separate video after like explaining the chapter where I like discuss with you individual mistakes that I made and some really good questions, standard answers that you should know, 6 mark answers, etc. So yeah, I hope this video helped you. If it did, please save this to your watch later playlist, like this video, subscribe to my channel, share this video with your friends, turn on post notifications, and let's get through this together.